Sabila, who works in the book publishing industry, founded COVID-19 Law Support 4 days after losing her community activist father to the virus. The group not only provides a safe space for members to grieve their losses, but also provides them with health support services, as well as memorial and media opportunities, connecting and amplifying the advocacy efforts of the COVID community across the country and around the world. Before we jump to the panel discussion, we're going to hear from Sabila as she shares her story and centers us on why we must fight and why she's joined the fight with Right to Health Action.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? My name is Sabila Khan, and I am one of the millions of Americans who have lost a loved one to COVID. My father, Shavkat Khan, was the loving father of three, the doting grandfather of seven, and the devoted husband to my mother for what would have been 50 years last October. He was also a community activist here in Jersey City who spent years carving out spaces and opportunities for others. He conducted voter registration drives, helped new immigrants find jobs and housing, and aided families facing immigration issues. And post 9/11, he organized panels bringing together Jersey City's many diverse communities so that we could talk beyond our differences and find common ground. My father was a good human being who devoted himself to family and community. On March 11th, as the tri-state area started to go into lockdown, the rehab facility where my father was receiving physical therapy for his Parkinson's closed its doors to visitors. We never saw him again. After a week of growing increasingly alarmed when he stopped answering his phone, we were told that my father was congested, had lost his appetite and his ability to speak, and had a low-grade fever. He was rushed to a hospital 3 blocks away from us, where he spent 3 days in a war zone of an ER waiting for a hospital bed. He died alone without his family by his side 4 days later on Tuesday, April 14th. It takes my breath away to imagine the fear, isolation, and trauma that my father suffered during the last week of his life. It's something that will haunt me for the rest of mine. My father was buried the following day, and in what was the most surreal and heartbreaking moment of my life, I had to watch his burial live streamed on my phone. No one's father deserves this, and no family deserves the lack of closure, the feelings of guilt and anxiety, and the burden of COVID grief that my family has been struggling with over the past 14 months. But sadly, my story is not unique. Last week, we surpassed 600,000 COVID deaths. For every COVID death, there are an estimated 9 close family members left behind. That's an estimated 5.4 million Americans left with PTSD, feelings of guilt and anxiety, and lack of closure. Our nation is experiencing a tsunami of grief. In trying to navigate my own trauma, I took the lessons I learned from my community activist father, and 4 days after he died, I co-founded COVID-19 Law Support for Family and Friends, the first Facebook bereavement group for people dealing with COVID loss. We're now the largest COVID loss support group in the country with over 10,000 members from all 50 states and around the world who have lost a loved one to this virus. In a time when we're more divided than ever, when social media and our news cycle presents a landmine of triggers for our community, and when it feels like the rest of the country is moving on without us, our group has become a safe space where people from all walks of life, religions, and political leanings can come together and carry one another in their grief. Because here's the thing, COVID is an equal opportunity killer, and everyone is deserving of community and comfort. In addition to providing a virtual community, we also provide our members with curated lists of free and low-cost mental health resources, ongoing memorial opportunities, 4 weekly admin-led Zoom calls, free meditation classes, and media opportunities. Our group has been a central resource for other COVID groups, both in the advocacy and memorial spaces. And we are continuously thinking of ways to maximize our outreach to the millions around the world who are dealing with COVID loss. It's been a little over 14 months since my father died. I still miss him desperately. I wish I could have saved him, but I've managed to take my deepest, rawest, and loneliest grief and impossibly created something beautiful from it. In doing this, I know I've made my father proud.
Wow. Thank you so much for sharing your powerful story with us tonight, Sibila. And I'm so sorry for your loss. Your experiences and those of countless others worldwide really drive home the importance of fighting for substantial changes to U.S. public health and global health policy at this crucial moment in time. Together, Right to Health Action is taking action to promote policies that further our ongoing goal of ending this pandemic and preventing pandemics of the future. Today, we're grateful and honored to be joined by Dr. Tom Frieden for a conversation on global vaccine manufacturing and access. Before I hand it over to our moderator, Chris Noble, I want to take this opportunity to thank him, Dr. Frieden, and our Right to Health team members who've joined us for multiple meetings to make this event happen. If you're interested in being involved in our community going forward, we'll be following up with information on how that's possible. Before we get started, a couple of quick notes on technology. You'll notice that all attendees are muted during this event. You can submit questions anytime via the chat. We will refer to these questions during the Q&A portion of the event at the second half. If you happen to leave the meeting at any point or get kicked out and want to rejoin, simply use the same link that you originally joined with. We're also recording this event so that we can share this for the future in the coming week. So just a note. And with that, let me go ahead and introduce Chris Noble from the Right to Health Action Team. Chris is a public health policy advisor and community organizer. As a former community fellow for the Marshall Gans Leadership Organizing and Action Program at Harvard Kennedy School, he serves as our community organizing lead. He's also served as a community organizer with countless other organizations such as Healthcare for All, Right Care Alliance, Mass Care, Universities Allied for Essential Medicines, Partners in Health Engage, and the 100 Campaign. Chris has worked in Latin America, East and Southern Africa, on health system implementation science with Partners in Health and Harvard Medical School. He was called to health justice advocacy from a personal diagnosis of type 1 diabetes as a child, and understanding firsthand the importance of fighting for healthcare as a human right guaranteed for all. Thank you so much for joining us, Chris. I'll let you go ahead and introduce Dr. Frieden and the focus of today's conversation.
Great, thank you, Akshita. And thank you for everyone for joining us tonight to hear what more we can do to ensure global vaccine access. First, I'm gonna introduce our host tonight, Dr. Tom Frieden. So Dr. Tom Frieden is a physician trained in internal medicine, infectious diseases, public health, and epidemiology. He is the former director of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention under President Obama and former commissioner of the New York City Health Department. Dr. Frieden is currently the president and CEO of Resolve to Save Lives, an initiative of the global health organization Vital Strategies. As Dr. Frieden began his public health career in New York City, identifying and then leading the effort that stopped the largest outbreak of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis to occur in the United States, he was then assigned to India, on loan from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, where he helped scale up a program for effective tuberculosis diagnosis, treatment, and monitoring. Asked to return to New York City to become Mayor Mike Bloomberg's health commissioner, he directed efforts to reduce smoking and other leading causes of death that increase life expectancy by 3 years. As director of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, Dr. Frieden oversaw the work that helped end the 2014 West Africa Ebola epidemic. He now leads Resolve to Save Lives, an initiative of the global health organization Vital Strategies that partners with countries to prevent 100 million deaths and to make the world safer from epidemics. During the COVID pandemic, Dr. Frieden has overseen an expansion of Resolve to Save Lives activities, including policy and program innovations in the United States, counsel and support to multilateral institutions, and support for rapid response, healthcare worker safety, and data-driven decision-making in more than 20 different countries. Dr. Frieden is also a senior fellow for global health at the Council on Foreign Relations. Welcome, Dr. Frieden, and thank you so much for joining us today.
It's my pleasure to be with you, and very sorry for the loss, Sibila Khan, of your father. Thank you for the work that you do, and it's always important to think about the lives and the faces behind the numbers, and the 600,000 Americans and probably 10 million people around the world who've had a family member whose deaths all of whom are somebody's family member.
Thank you, Dr. Frieden. And I thought we'd get us started in our conversation. If you could just give us a brief lay of the land from your perspectives and from your experience around the world, managing epidemics and helping the world to be healthier. You know, what is happening right now around global vaccine access, and what opportunities are presently available to get us closer to the global herd immunity needed to get us through COVID as quickly as possible? Could you just give us a quick lay of the land from your perspective?
Yeah, I mean, right now we're just in a terrible situation. Globally, we're seeing the Delta variant spread increasingly. We're seeing explosive spread in more than a dozen countries of Africa. Cases are coming down now in Latin America, but that's before the Delta variant has hit hard there. There's a cautionary note, two cautionary notes. One from the United Kingdom, which is having an increase in cases despite one of the highest vaccination rates in the world, with nearly every case being Delta variant. And then in Israel, which also has an extraordinarily high vaccination rate, they're seeing some problems in schools because kids aren't vaccinated yet. We don't have a vaccine for kids under 12. So we have this tale of two pandemic worlds, one in which there's adequate vaccine. And in the US, the pandemic is tamed. That doesn't mean it's over. And it doesn't mean there won't be clusters and cases. And we're still having far too many deaths. But also, we have parts of the US which continue to lack ready access, trust, understanding of the need to get vaccinated. The harvest of the politicization of the pandemic and of the response, we continue to reap the divisions in the society. And globally, we have a horrific inequity with lack of access to vaccines. You know, just a number, wealthy countries have given 60 vaccines per 100 people. Low-income countries, one or fewer. So it's as happened with HIV, right? The treatment becomes available and the rich folks get it. And so the challenge here is that the solution is not simple. There are some things that can be done quickly. Excess vaccine can be reallocated quickly. Vaccine can be used better. In areas that are having explosive spread, vaccine isn't going to stop the explosive spread. You have to mask, distance, stop super spreading events. But what worries me most, and Marine Boussonnier is on our staff and told me to meet with you folks, and I do whatever Marine tells me to do. We have been advocating now for 6 months to use the Bayh-Dole marching rights, or at least the threat of them, to get Moderna, which has a product that was created with US taxpayer money, for which NIH developed the patents, to get them not just to not enforce IP, but to do hands-on tech transfer with hubs that can then be train the trainers so that we can ramp up vaccine supply. That had been done 6 months ago, we would already have vaccine rolling off the production lines. I know there are calls for other approaches and there may be better approaches, but that's the best one I know.
Sure, thank you so much for sharing that. And I'm so glad you began describing, you know, what we can do to truly get, you know, shots into arms, as it said, as quickly as possible and contain this virus before it spreads into a variant that our current vaccine regimen is unable to control. You know, given the description of the problem and some of the solutions you just put forward for vaccine access, you know, what can we at Right to Health, you know, a group of grassroots advocates across the country, you know, trained in advocacy and you know, setting up frequent meetings with our members of Congress, you know, on these important issues, what can we do on the call today to support in this becoming a reality? Do you see some avenues for advocacy that we can really get behind?
I think, you know, if every elected official contacts the White House and says, why haven't you forced Moderna to do active tech transfer? Why didn't you do it 6 months ago? Why aren't you doing it today? That could only help.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you for that.
And I think also that Moderna needs to hear. Yeah, I was on a panel with them And I said to Stefan Bonsall, the CEO, you have a choice. You can be a hero or a hero or a devil. Which is it going to be?
Yeah. Yeah, so I mean, building on that a little bit, you know, we've seen that the Biden administration has taken some initial steps to support at least negotiation for a TRIPS waiver of the COVID-19 vaccine patents. You know, I'd love to hear your reflections on that. And also, you know, how do we ensure that the Biden administration follows through on this commitment to ensure a timely agreement is in place as soon as possible?
Yeah, I think you have to distinguish what's needed longer term and what's needed now. And I'm afraid that the IP waiver may not really get what's needed. It's kind of, if it's used, I'll be really blunt. Mm-hmm. If it's used as a bargaining chip with industry, mm-hmm. like you better play right and share or else, fine. But the fact is, sharing IP is not what's needed. Mm-hmm. These are tough vaccines to make. Mm-hmm. And if you just share the IP, the other companies are going to have to go through an RCT. So you're talking about a year or more and a lot of uncertainty. Look at CureVac. We all hoped CureVac would be a third great mRNA vaccine. It's got a lot of characteristics that we thought would be better than the others. People pre-ordered 1 billion doses. And it doesn't work. An RCT is a randomized controlled trial. So if you use Moderna's vaccine through their technology that they license to you, you can get it approved by any regulatory authority. Mm-hmm. If you reverse engineer their vaccine and make it yourself, you're going to have to go through all of the studies. You're going to have to enroll people. You're going to have to see if it works. You're going to have to document that it's safe, and maybe it won't. So the, you know, the fact of life is we can't do this without the companies collaborating. But yeah, they've got to have carrots and sticks to collaborate.
Yeah, so let's go back to that mRNA technology. I mean, this is a technology that's been around for a few decades, and it really has the potential, you know, to change the world, frankly, through an entirely new frontier of drug development for treatments such as cancer, other metabolic disease states, autoimmune conditions, et cetera. So how do you see us getting to a place where there's a global infrastructure in place for not just building up the capacity sufficient to create COVID-19 vaccines to get us through this pandemic, but also be prepared, you know, a pandemic-proof planet where we have the global manufacturing capacity for these novel innovations that can hopefully stop the next one in its tracks?
Right. Well, I don't think we should get ahead of ourselves. mRNA, as you said, it's been under development for 20 years. Fortunately, it was available for this pandemic, but we don't know that it's going to be great for other viruses. It may well be for influenza, for dengue, for other things. It may be a great vaccine platform, but we don't know that for sure. It would be great to have mRNA factories ready to go all around the world. So that if there's a new pathogen, we can ramp up. But right now, I think we need to focus on the pandemic at hand. And I have to say, the protein subunit vaccines, that's the Novavax vaccine, and there's some other ones out there. That's another one that's very promising. And the reason we're very interested in mRNA and protein subunit is that they basically take a biological process, which is not very certain. Lots can go wrong and does go wrong. And they convert it to a chemical process where it's much more predictable. Mm-hmm. So the mRNA vaccines are an insurance policy against bad variants because they're stronger vaccines, mm-hmm. against production failures because almost every one of the other vaccines has had production problems. And the protein subunit, the jury is still out, but they look very promising as well. So I think I go back to a history lesson. 120 years ago, 130 years ago, the New York City Health Department, which I had the honor of being commissioner of for 8 years, produced vaccines and biologicals and sold them to other public health departments around the country. Now, People say, oh, you know, government will never be able to make things. That's for industry. But in Brazil, there are two companies that are publicly owned that make high quality medications and biologicals and vaccines. You've got Cuba with a vaccine that apparently works well, or two that work well, government owned. So I don't buy that only industry can do this right. And in fact, a lot of the mRNA technology was developed by the government. On the other hand, there are things that industry does really well. They can move faster than government. And so I guess I come to this from a standpoint of how can we get the best results as quickly as possible.
Yeah, thank you for that. And you know, it is going to take, you know, upwards of, you know, 8 billion doses of vaccine to truly reach global herd immunity, you know, as quickly as possible. And as admirable as the COVAX effort was to try to coordinate global vaccine supply and get it into these low resource settings, you know, they're just not hitting the numbers they need to truly get to a place to control these variants as they're popping up.
Yeah, so, you know that the in 2020, industry missed its production targets by 96%.
Yeah.
And in 2021, they're missing their production targets by 70%. Mm-hmm. So what's happening is the industry is saying, trust us, we got it controlled, there'll be plenty of vaccine. Yeah, like when, after how many millions more people die? So that's why I think the drumbeat is force Moderna to actively share and do tech transfer, ideally to hubs.
Yeah.
And we've looked around the world. You know, it's fashionable to say vaccine should be made in Africa, and it should be. But you're starting from a much lower base there. It's not going to be happening in the next year. I spoke today with the head of the Africa WHO, and she said, you know, I don't care where the vaccine comes from, as long as we get it here.
Yeah.
There are countries such as Korea, Brazil, India, that really have an infrastructure for developing large-scale manufacture.
And so you spoke a bit about, you know, these march-in rights that the U.S. government has to be able to seize these patents that, you know, were either correctly invested with our public funds through the National Institute of Health, as well as, you know, the research was directly funded through this Operation Warp Speed initiative, speaking specifically to Moderna. Could you speak a bit more to, you know, what the U.S. government can do, and particularly the Biden administration can do right now to help drive this tech transfer? I mean, what tools do we have in our tool chest, and how do we get them used?
I think basically they meet with Moderna and they say, do this or else. And if you do it, we will guarantee you important sales, so that they've got all upside and no downside from participating.
Yeah.
There may be another way to do it. I don't know. I'm looking at some of the things coming in the chat. First issue that came in was immunosuppression, and it's a big issue. There are 10 million Americans who have immunosuppression, and we just don't know as much as we wish we knew about how well immunosuppressed people are protected, and whether antibody testing is helpful, and whether a third dose would be helpful. I would say it's talk to your doctor, stay tuned. Article just came out yesterday that some people who didn't respond did respond to a third dose. Although if they hadn't gotten the third dose, they might have responded anyway. You just don't know that. Next question was, when is Novavax going to be available? It probably is not going to be available in the US anytime soon, because there are already such good vaccines here. It's a high burden to get it approved. So it may be available globally before it's available here. It is an adjuvanted vaccine, which means it has a chemical in it that increases the immune response. I think some people will be nervous about that. So I still think the mRNA technologies are the most promising. There's a question about Puerto Rico. Absolutely. You know, there were tax incentives there. They were taken away. The economy tanked. It's something to explore. Puerto Rico's economic situation is very problematic, as you know. And they do have manufacture potential. And there's a lot of talk to onshoring the supply chain for many different product. So that's something to explore.
Yeah. And, you know, in regards to this manufacturing scale up that you're describing, so, you know, during Operation Warp Speed, there was a rampant scale up of new manufacturing capacity here in the United States. And, you know, it happened fairly quickly and also very safely to develop these vaccines that are now being distributed. You know, in your perspective, you know, what critical steps need to be taken to vaccinate the world as quickly as possible? And what do you think that timeline looks like if we were to be ramping up this tech transfer?
Yeah, I mean, really, I think it can happen within 6 to 9 months. But Marine analyzed actually what the companies have done, and they started production within 3 months. So you're talking about 3 to 6 months from go, which is not bad. Yeah. You know, the old saying, the best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. The second best time is now.
Yes, right.
But we've been saying that since January. Mm-hmm. So if we had, you know, happened in January, and I really do like the idea of hubs, because if what the companies want to do is they want to transfer tech to one other company that they own, or that they have a license agreement with. That's what they're used to doing. But if instead they were to transfer with a consortium, where you're bringing together multiple companies and government, you really have the ability of moving very quickly to produce a huge quantity of vaccines. I'm just thinking about some of the comments. I think we don't know what mRNA will be good for besides COVID. There's a lot of hope that it'll be good for a lot of things, including some things that are currently very expensive.
Yeah.
What are called biologicals, medications that, you know, they're disgracefully expensive in the US, $3,000 a month, $10,000 a month, and probably can be made for dollars with mRNA technology. But that's going to take years to work out.
Sure.
And I think as one of the carrots to get Moderna to play has to be protecting their IP for other products. I mean, we may philosophically not like that idea, but that may be necessary. There's a question about vaccine hesitancy in Africa, and it's a big issue. We're hearing it, we're seeing it. We have operations in Africa, and so there's no magic wand to make this go away. The right messages, the right messengers. Africa didn't get hit hard the first time around. A, they did really good work with public health. B, they're a much younger population, so it's going to be less lethal. And C, they got hit harder than people realized because they don't do a very good job of tracking deaths. But now with the Delta variant, it's as if it's a different disease and they're seeing lots of deaths. And I think sadly, that'll be the most effective way to reduce hesitancy. I think on the doses that are close to expiry, it's a mess because, you know, there's a bad history of sending expired product overseas. They've already been distributed. It's a messy situation. You know, the issue of waiting more time between doses, I think the story hasn't been told on that completely. With the AstraZeneca, the data suggested that a 12-week interval was better than a 3-week interval. But, you know, you don't have the counterfactual. It wasn't really a rigorous study. So you don't know if it's just that people continue to grow their immune response. And, you know, there was this tense debate about should we use just a single dose of the mRNA because when we didn't have enough. And that's still debated. And I didn't think we should change because, you know, take as directed, use what's been proven. And now it's clear that a single dose doesn't protect you against the Delta variant.
Mm-hmm.
Now, again, I don't like thinking that's based on what happened or didn't happen, but it's worth knowing.
Of course. So let's go back to, you know, you've worked on issues of outbreak preparedness well beyond vaccines as well. Would you mind sharing your thoughts on, you know, the top two or three issues in your mind that need to be tackled beyond vaccine preparedness for preventing the next pandemic?
Well, I don't know if I can limit it to three.
That's so,
One is to strengthen public health systems. And that means systems to find, stop, and prevent the spread of health threats. We've been working on this at Resolve for 4 years now. Mm. And countries around the world have identified more than 10,000 life-threatening gaps. It's going to cost somewhere around $10 billion a year for a decade to close those gaps. And it's not going to be able to be done quickly. What we have is kind of panic, neglect cycle. Panic, neglect, repeat. And that's not a way to build systems. You need to train people, you need to hire them, you need to promote them, you need to continuously improve their skills, develop information systems, rapid response capacity, legal capacity, communication skills, reach into communities that have distrust for government. This is a long-term need. One is public health. The second is primary health care. Everywhere, almost everywhere in the world, primary health care is the weakest part of the healthcare system. And it's weak because we don't pay. We don't structure our healthcare system so that primary healthcare pays well. Mm. You know, people say, oh, why do we have so many radiologists and so few primary care doctors? Well, radiologists make 2, 3, 4 times as much as primary care doctors. It doesn't take, you know, a genius to figure out why we have a lot of radiologists. Mm. And so we need to change the way we pay for primary healthcare in this country and around the world to make it pay, because it is so important to detect problems, to keep people resilient by controlling their conditions, chronic conditions, and to deliver vaccines and other treatments.
Yeah, thank you for that, 100%.
Sorry, that was only two.
Yeah.
Two more to mention.
Sure.
One is the animal-human interface.
Certainly.
And the risk of spillover events, mm-hmm. and also the risk of laboratory accidents. Mm-hmm. You know, whatever happened or didn't happen in Wuhan, and we may or may not ever know, both of these are risks.
Yeah.
They're real risks to humanity, and we need to reduce the risk. We'll probably never make that risk zero, but we should do a lot more than we're doing now to reduce the risk, including through addressing deforestation, addressing alternate protein sources in places that depend on food from the forest areas, of having an enforceable plan in place to stop the sale of wild animals for food.
Yeah.
Of really, you know, we're just not even trying there. Similarly, on laboratory safety, there's no global compact as there is for nuclear or chemical weapons. And I know that that can't make things you know, perfectly safe, but we can certainly make them a lot safer. So four things.
Certainly, yeah. I mean, you're speaking our language right now, Doctor. You know, there has been a historic call for a new financing mechanism for pandemic preparedness. We're calling it a Global Pandemic Prevention Fund. And this is something that Right to Health Action has been at the forefront of this fight to get enacted ever since the beginning of COVID back early last year. And so, you know, just some quick background, experts have reported extensively on the total global costs needed to truly pandemic-proof the planet, you know, including the worldwide costs of pandemic preparedness, as well as prevention, like you were mentioning, this reduction in dependence on deforestation and you know, families going into these zoonotic hotspots and putting themselves and their community and our world at risk if there is to be an outbreak that's not contained. You know, and this cost could be prevented around annual investments of as low as $20 billion. I mean, $20 billion compared to the almost $20 trillion that we lost because of COVID-19. So in response to this, 120 members of Congress recently signed a bipartisan letter to the Biden administration urging the White House for $2 billion in seed funding for such a fund, for this Global Pandemic Prevention Fund. President Biden's budget, recently announced about 2 weeks ago, included only $250 million for this fund, 1/12 of what's required to truly pandemic-proof the planet in these 500 zoonotic hotspots that have been identified across the world. So with that said and that background, you know, how much money really is needed from the United States government to get this new multilateral pandemic prevention fund started? You know, and what amount will indicate seriousness to bring other donors to the table to share this cost?
Well, I mean, I'm not quite sure if your idea of that pandemic prevention fund is specifically around spillover or
would you guess?
Yeah. Okay.
It would have two elements. It would be both spillover events in terms of, you know, reducing the chances of zoonotic transfer in these zoonotic hotspots. So breaking the dependency of families on deforestation and other kind of risky, only available opportunities for these families in these hotspots, but also the containment element of if there can be alternative jobs programs where communities can learn about contact tracing, community health work, other types of community reinforcement programs that break that dependency on deforestation as the only means of economic well-being. How can both of those things combined, you know, which has been proven models that we've seen from our partners in Health and Harmony. We've spoken with them in previous webinars here at Right to Health Action. You know, what are your thoughts on this model and what's a true commitment from the US government that can be extensive enough to pandemic proof the planet? What does that look like to you?
Right. So there are a lot of questions there. One is simply the mechanism. Creating a new entity is going to take a long time and be very controversial. Maybe it'll work, and there are some within the US government who are pushing for that. My personal belief is that it's not likely to work, and it has a significant possibility that it will derail the momentum. If you look at the existing institutions, I think, as does my organization, that the Global Fund is the best suited to be adapted to create a pandemic window. Now, that's not a clear shot because you've got, frankly, HIV, TB, malaria advocates who don't want the Global Fund to get into this because they think it'll detract attention from those crucial issues. You've got the rest of public health that doesn't want the Global Fund in this because they resent the Global Fund and are jealous. And you've got the Global Fund itself, which may have a little bit too much of a sense that we're already doing pandemic prevention because HIV, TB, and malaria are pandemics. So I don't see a clear shot to getting this right, but I wouldn't give up on the Global Fund as the home for this. That's in terms of mechanism.
Sure.
In terms of amounts, no one knows for sure. For the work that we did on just the public health side, not spillover, but detection, response, we consistently got around $1 per person per year for low and middle income countries, a little more in some places, a little less in others. That doesn't include primary care. That doesn't include research. That doesn't include stockpiling. That doesn't include safer health facilities. But that gives you a number of $10 billion or so per year. I know that the group on EcoHealth has come up with a similar number for spillover prevention. I worry about these numbers because A, how firm are they really? And B, even if you got them, would you be able to implement? Would you have the mechanisms to get them through? It's not easy to spend money well in global health. On the one hand, by all means, push for more money faster, but also think about how to have smart money, because ultimately it's a long haul issue. And if we're not in it for the long haul, we're not going to succeed.
Yeah, thank you for that. And, you know, it's noteworthy that the Biden administration has already committed $250 million for this type of pandemic preparedness. And, you know, we're hoping as an organization to push them a little further through this next state and foreign operations funding cycle for FY22. We were hoping to get them closer to that $2 billion number, just so that, you know, if the United States can show leadership in this space and bring in, you know, other high-income countries to the table, this can be an effort that's shared amongst other kind of high-resource settings. So I guess time will tell, but we're hoping to see the fruits of our labor over the past few months with the announcement this week on that SFOPS language. So
just remember that it's going to be very difficult to do things without bipartisan support, and that means that doing this in a partisan way is probably not going to make a difference. Now you've got some leaders on both sides of the aisle Tom Cole, who for a long time was the only Native American in Congress, is a thoughtful individual. I don't agree with all of his positions, but he has been saying for years that Americans are much more likely to be killed by a pandemic than by a terrorist.
Sure.
And so I think we need to look for that kind of common ground.
Great. So, you know, I'm trying to see if there's any questions here in the chat that might come up. I see some people discussing. This is going back to vaccination questions here. How much longer? You know, so we do, I guess we could say that, you know, my team is informing me that Rich and McCall are leading the push for a global pandemic fund, who are two Republicans. So we are trying to make this a bipartisan effort as much as we can in both the House and the Senate. But yeah, that truly is what's needed. And you know, pandemics, as much as they've been politicized in the United States, you know, this is an issue that affects us all. And we're hoping that, you know, in the effort of global security as well as national security, this is something that we can all get behind.
Just in terms of some of the vaccine questions, we hope by the end of the year, maybe sooner, maybe later, vaccines will be available for kids under the age of 12. There's still a lot we don't know about breakthrough infections, how long vaccine protection lasts, whether we'll need boosters. I really got annoyed at the companies saying, we'll definitely need boosters. We don't know that. We know that some antibody tests wane, but we don't know if that means protection wanes. I mean, the way we'll know, frankly, if we need boosters is if people start getting the virus after a year or two or three or five or 10. So I think there's a lot we still don't know. And it's really important that science rather than profits and industry are what's driving that decision. I think, you know, the point that someone's made here about immunosuppressed people is very, very important because we don't know. And I didn't agree with the CDC guidance on, unmask everybody. It really depends on who you are, where you are, and what you're doing. So if you're immunosuppressed, or you live with someone who's immunosuppressed, or if you're not vaccinated, you need to mask. If you're in a place where there's a lot of COVID, you want to mask, even if you're vaccinated. And if you're doing something like an aerobics class, you know, I think you should probably mask. And interestingly, with so many people unmasking, those who may be unprotected may want to mask better with an N95, a KN95, or a tightly fitting multi-layer mask.
So this is a great question that just came in from John. You know, what is the best estimate of actual number of vaccine doses needed? I think this is in reference to getting to global herd immunity. He's saying estimates seem to assume perfect allocation among and within countries, or maybe, you know, how could this number be useful to aim towards?
Yeah, it's a tough one. It's a tough one, but you know, it's definitely north of 10 billion. And the problem is that the vaccine manufacturers are giving wildly optimistic numbers, and they include vaccines that may not be very effective against the variants. That's why we've been screaming for 6 months, make a hub for mRNA.
Yeah.
Or multiple hubs.
Yeah, so I have some figures to back that up. So, you know, as of May 5th, you know, the COVAX initiative had only delivered, I think it was 53 million shots to 121 countries. You know, that's 22.7 of the 237 million doses that were due to be delivered by now. And that's also only 2.7% of COVAX's goal of 2 billion doses by the end of 2021.
And so, their goal is 20% vaccination. I mean, what kind of a goal is that, right? Yeah, we're aiming to fail. If you aim to fail, you're probably going to fail.
That's right. Yeah, so let's go back to a bit about global, you know, manufacturing scale up. So, you know, I'm curious what you think about, you know, BARDA, which is the Biomedical Advanced Research and Development Authority. You obviously know this, but for everyone on the call, of the Department of Health and Human Services, you know, To rapidly scale manufacturing capacity around the world, both in the United States and these regional manufacturing hubs that you're describing, you know, whatever degree necessary, wherever necessary to produce these 8 billion to 10 billion vaccine doses as soon as possible, you know, really, yeah. And just like a quick, how do we get there? I mean, how do we get from 2.7% of COVAX's goal, which is already an underestimate of the need, to the true, the 8 to 10 billion numbers? Like, map out the next 3 to 6 months in your ideal world, if all political situations worked out, how do we truly get to shots in arms in this 3 to 6 month timeframe?
Yeah, well, there are a lot of unknowns. So the vaccines from China and Russia, maybe they'll have large numbers. Mm. Novavax and other protein subunit vaccines, maybe they'll have large numbers. They're talking about 100 million a month, you know, but when you put that against 10 billion, you've got a problem. Then again, you've got vaccine hesitancy, yeah. And you've got challenges getting vaccine into different places. So it's a real challenge. But what worries me is, if you keep on doing what you've always done, you'll get the results you've always gotten. That's right. And what we've always gotten is too little, too late. And that's what we're getting now. In terms of vaccine, I don't see any better way than mRNA production hubs. It's our best insurance against variants and production failure, and the potential volumes are huge. You need something like the Defense Production Act for the world.
Yeah.
You'd need to kind of figure out all of the different supply chain problems. Mm-hmm. That's why we're very enthusiastic about a place like Korea, which has an industrial policy and can get all of government, all of industry working together.
Yeah, thank you for that. I love that idea of a defense.
On long haul COVID, let me just do a commercial, and maybe Kaylin from our office can put it in. We just did a review of the science of long haul COVID. It's really well done. I think it went out last week. Maybe it's going out today or tomorrow, but we'll get it to people. I can't remember. There's a lot we don't know about long haul COVID, but we know that people who are sick and hospitalized tend to really take a long time to recover. Yeah. But we also know that some people who weren't very sick at all can develop long haul symptoms, and we don't know what causes them. We don't know how to treat them. We don't know how long lasting they will be. We don't know a lot of what we need to do.
So we're advocating, we're going to talk about this in a moment, about what's been called the NOVID bill. I'm sure you're familiar with this effort. And an aspect of it is the development, the funding and development of basically a surveillance network for variants and other zoonotic potential viruses, based loosely off of our existing influenza surveillance network that's monitoring for variants and trying to use that information to develop new therapies and new vaccines that can help protect us to the best of our ability at that timeline. Do you see something like that possible for COVID-19? And how do you think we can get to somewhere where that type of pandemic-proofed planet is possible?
Yeah, I think we have to be careful about bright, shiny objects.
Sure.
Right, and so genomic sequencing is an amazing tool and it's really important. But what you really need is the epidemiology to go along with it. You need to have the case investigations, the contact investigations, the clinical data. And so I think there's a certain kind of syndrome, if you will. You say a few things, AI, machine learning, genomic sequencing, maybe throw in Bitcoin, and everything's gonna be all fine, right? But really, I'm sorry, the world works a little differently. You need people who are expert, who work hard, who have access to power, who have access to money, who have access to media, who think hard, who adapt based on how the data changes. And that's how you have an effective response. There was a question about other vaccine types, and I want to just mention it because I think any vaccine that works well, we should scale up as much as possible. The J&J vaccine has a lot going for it. Mm-hmm. Sinovac, a lot of the countries that used it are still having large outbreaks, although one recent analysis from Chile suggests that it was not in fully vaccinated people. And one of the things we're seeing around the world is in multi-dose vaccines, people who aren't fully vaccinated get sick, and it undermines confidence in the vaccine. The Sputnik vaccine is actually a very clever design. Whether they can produce enough safely is another question. But I hope they will. I mean, the more proven vaccines available from anywhere, the better. There's no enemy here among people. The enemy is a virus. And if you remember, health has often been a bridge for peace. At the height of the Cold War, the US and then Soviet Union collaborated on smallpox eradication as a safe space. And then in the 80s, when Jim Grant from UNICEF was pushing for child vaccination, he was doing the rounds on the phone with all of his country directors and seeing whether they were getting to 80% vaccination, which was the target then. Mm-hmm. And El Salvador came in and it was very low. And he was yelling at his country director and he said, "Sir, there's a war going on here." And Grant said, "Well, stop it." And they did. They actually created Días de Tranquilidad, where the whole country agreed that they would compete for who could vaccinate people better in their part of the country, rather than who could kill more people.
Yeah,
that's beautiful. So we should think of this as a possible bridge to peace.
I love that. I love that idea. I want to get back to really quickly, and I know we're running close on time here. You know, so there is COVID fatigue all over the world, especially here in high resource settings where we've been fortunate enough to have more a surplus of vaccines and compared to what's happening in the rest of the world, particularly in the US, where we're seeing a drop in interest now that many of us have been vaccinated. You know, how do we truly maintain the focus on US policymakers on this crucial issue and not let it become another unsolved pandemic for developing countries like HIV/AIDS? How can we maintain that pressure?
I don't have a great answer for you. The answer is contained in your question, which is that you need to maintain the pressure. But I will tell you a story. When I first started as CDC director, I met with Senator Inouye, a remarkable man who was then chairman of appropriations. And I asked him how we could get more money for global health. And yes, Paul, he did pass away, and rest in peace. I asked him how we could get more money for global health. Mm-hmm. And he said, memorably, in his very measured voice, slowly, "Don't tell us the good things that will happen if we give you the money. Tell us the bad things that will happen to us if we don't give you the money." And I think it was good advice. You know, I want to just say, I'm going to put in a non-commercial advertisement here.
Please.
Just for a group of advocates. Do you know what the most lethal, under-addressed health problem is in the US and the world?
What is that?
Hypertension.
Yes.
High blood pressure. Mm. High blood pressure kills more people than all infectious diseases combined. In the US, it is the leading cause of the difference in Black-white life expectancy. 1 out of 4 Black people in the US has elevated blood pressure untreated or inadequately treated versus 1 out of 7 white people, still shockingly high for whites, but unconscionably high for Black people. And prevention is possible by reducing sodium intake, and the FDA has been sitting on action, not doing anything on that for years and years, and they could do it. And treatment is inexpensive and generic, but you need primary health care in the US and globally. So I wanted to just put in a plug for activists, because we don't have enough activists against stroke and heart attack and kidney failure, which are largely preventable conditions. So I just wanted, since I know you're all very effective advocates, to ask, don't forget about hypertension, because that is the world's leading killer, number one, public health enemy number one, and very preventable.
Certainly, and a lot of these issues obviously have intersectoral problems with the racial issues in our country and the need for racial justice to be preventing these race-related, you know, diseases. You know, there's a reason why people with hypertension are the Black people in the United States, and that's because of the racist institutions that have created an unhealthy living place for many of us here. And so, but that's a great place to end. Thank you, Tom. I'm going to pass it back to Akshita to close us out and give us a call to action. Thank you for this conversation.
Thank you all.
Yeah. Thank you both for taking the time to speak with us this evening. Dr. Frieden, so grateful for you sharing all your wisdom and your perspective. And thank you to Chris for helping to moderate the conversation. I don't know about the rest of the audience, but I know I learned a lot. I was definitely just taking notes in the background here, trying to remember things to look up and things to commit to memory when talking about vaccines with others. So I hope that, you know, today's discussion has helped everybody appreciate the fundamental link between vaccine access and putting an end to not just this pandemic, but all pandemics, you know, creating a pandemic-free future worldwide. If the conversation that you heard today has struck a chord with you, we encourage you to join us in advocating for the crucial policies as discussed by our speakers today. There are countless ways for you to get involved in this work, but I'll present to you just three options today. The first one is quite easy. It's as simple as clicking a couple buttons on your computer, which you could do right now, and that is to sign a petition, sending a letter to President Biden, urging him to help vaccinate the world. This will take just 30 seconds, so we urge you to do that now before you leave. The other great way to take action is to do exactly what Dr. Frieden was saying, you know, asking our members of Congress to call on President Biden, call on the White House to do more about this issue, and that's something we're doing right now. So our Right to Health Action teams in states across the country are meeting with hundreds of members of Congress to encourage them to back these key policies for equitable access to medicines and vaccines, and to not just voice their support, but to call on our president to do more. And so we're in the process of scheduling and holding those hundreds of meetings in the next couple of weeks to support the NOVID Act, a bill that's been introduced both in the House and the Senate. And we need all of your help to make sure that Congress is listening, right? We need all hands on deck to get this message across, to show that there's strong support for this bill, strong support for this cause, and really pushing this argument to the president's doorstep. So please sign up to join these meetings with our elected officials. All you need to do is to share your COVID story. It's just for a minute or two, and it looks like people have already been doing that in the chat. So thank you guys. And then lastly, we hope that you are able to keep the conversation going. Chat with your friends and family about what you learned tonight during this webin, as well as some of the other work that Right to Health Action is doing. Spreading awareness has been key to growing our movement, and we've also curated several resources to help read up on more information about vaccines that you can share with others when you have this conversation. So please refer to the chat box to access the links to the action items I just spoke about. If you have any questions about how to get involved, you can put them here in the chat or learn more by visiting our website at righttohealthaction.org. Also, please don't hesitate to reach out to us via email. You can find us at info@r2haction.org. Thank you all so much for being with us for tonight's event. And thank you again to Dr. Frieden and Chris Noble.